Okay, hello everyone. My name is Jeff Davis. I work for Aster Data, a part of Teradata, and I will be talking about temporal data management in Postgres, where we were a long time ago, where we're getting to today, and where we're going in the future. So first I'll start off with kind of a really simple, or what seemed like a simple problem a long time ago. I was just trying to devise some kind of a, you know, sort of audit trail, an auditable log of what changes had been made to the database over time. So you could imagine, in this case, it was a system involving fixed assets. So if an asset was reassigned, you know, from inventory to a person or from one person to another, you wanted to keep track of that. Not only the action itself or where the asset happened to be at that time, but also who may have done the reassignment in the database, so you could figure out what happened. It turned out to be a little bit more complicated than I thought because of the limitations of the system at the time. The primary query for any database problem, there's kind of two sides to it. One is the representation of the information, and the other is actually being able to query it in a useful way. So Postgres was able to represent those changes pretty readily with triggers, but doing the query itself, there weren't a lot of good mechanisms for that. And this isn't the whole problem, but it's just kind of what got me started down this path, is that I felt like this problem seemed like a typical problem and seemed like something that should be able to be handled efficiently, but it really wasn't. At every step, I felt like it was awkward. In particular, queries seemed awkward and they didn't perform well. So, one of the things about them, I mean, if you've done this kind of query, trying to, match up, what happened to records in the past, and trying to, specify date ranges over which that was valid, that kind of thing. How many people have written queries like that out in the field? Yeah, pretty much everyone. So you know a couple things. One of them is that you need to be really careful with the less than greater than. And you quickly come around to a convention, usually to kind of keep track of it better. But you have to be pretty careful. There's a tendency to use nulls for one side of the equation, but then those don't work with the greater than less than comparisons you really as you would want them to. So just specifying null on one side can break the queries that were working before for you. You've got to be careful of nulls. And then there's also other awkward things like just trying to represent single points of time or empty ranges of time. Poor performance. I'm glossing over this a little bit because this talk is more about the entire problem space. But if you look at how a query like this might have worked, quite a while ago, say in 8.3 or 8.4, then you look at this and basically I just when trying to write this example, I actually tried to get it to choose a different plan that was able to do a bitmap and, because a lot of times that can be a reasonable plan to execute this query, but for that even it's a little bit tricky to get it to choose that plan. Oftentimes it'll just use one index, even if there's an index available on both the kind of from time and the to time. If you have a query like this, does this kind of a query look familiar to most people in the room? Yeah, it's a typical temporal query to try and find, when you have, how it might have looked at some point in time when somebody made a decision. And so this plan is just not really workable. Even if the optimizer is able to choose a slightly better plan, that plan isn't really a great plan either. And from here, it basically just gets worse. So, I mean, this wasn't the end of the use case. I think that if this was kind of the end of the problems that you really want to solve with temporal data management, then I think most people can get by. You know, there's usually kind of ways you can work around it and manage the performance problems in other ways. But we'll see the problems get a little bit more complex, and there's more you want to do, and eventually it becomes unmanageable. So I tried to improve the situation through a few projects. Quite a while ago, I started. I just wrote an extension, and it was to make a data type called period. There was a period of time, basically only operated with one sub data type, and that was a timestamp with time zone, which is the typical out of the temporal types offered by Postgres. This is the one you'd ordinarily choose as a point in time. And so I wrote a data type around that held both a beginning point and an end point in time. And that allowed a couple of advantages, of course. It made the queries simpler, and it made them indexable because of Postgres's extensibility system. Having those two things together in one data type and being able to specify the necessary index support around it allowed it to perform better. I jumped ahead a little bit. I meant to list out a few of these other things, but this is kind of just a list, where we started, some features that have been added, some features that are in the process of being released, and where I intend to go in the future. But for the period data type, this is kind of where I started, and this provided kind of a first cut that solved the immediate problems. Like I said, making the queries faster and allowing the index infrastructure to be used. It obviated the confusion around greater than, less than signs by holding the inclusivity or exclusivity of the bounds internal to the type. And this was actually superseded by range types, which I'll go into in a little bit more detail. Since this was superseded, I don't want to describe the entire use pattern for this data type, of course. But this is where it started. This was making use of Postgres's extensibility to get us there. Then something that couldn't be done with Postgres's extensibility system at the time was also a seemingly pretty simple problem. And so no matter how much I tried to make an extension work to solve this problem, I couldn't. So I decided that we needed a core feature to provide an answer for avoiding schedule conflicts. Out of all the features that I saw at the time that I really needed to make temporal work, this was the one thing I thought, okay, there's no way of avoiding it. This must be in the core. So that prompted me to start writing some changes to core Postgres. And you can think of this kind of like a unique constraint, but it's more flexible in that it can allow you to actually prevent schedule conflicts. So I'll show an example here in a second. But to describe it, essentially unique means that if you have one tuple, and then that means that there's no other tuple with an equal value for that attribute anywhere in the table. And that's declarative, so that means the system enforces it, and you don't need, there's no other logic you have to follow. Just the existence of a tuple with a value of 5 means that no other tuple has a value of 5 for that unique attribute. Exclusion constraints allows you to kind of change that operator away from just equality to an operation that's very important for a temporal, which is overlaps. Let me move on to the example here. I think it'll be more clear. So you can create a table with a definition like this. And I'll get to this in a second here. This it was hard to develop a kind of simpler example and also not use the range types from later developments, which I'll get onto later. But this here, this TSTZ range, that's what supersedes the period data type, and that's what gives you that beginning and end and the indexability. And this one in particular is, you know, the same based on timestamp with time zone. So this create table has these two extra constraints down here that operate on this value in a special way, on this attribute in a special way. And the key is that we're treating room and speaker just with equality. So if the room matches and the time period you've got the room overlaps with somebody else, then there's a conflict. And that's what this constraint is describing. So with equality, you have to say only if they're equal is there a conflict. In this example, you can say, well, if the room is equal and during overlaps, then you have a conflict. Again, this is declarative, so the system enforces it internally in an efficient way, and you don't have to do anything more. You're just declaring this to be true, and then it works. Of course, neither you can't have the same room booked by different speakers for overlapping periods of time, but you also can't have the same speaker booked at two overlapping times in different rooms. So really, you have two separate constraints here. That's why you have this exclude twice. One is saying that the room can't be double booked for overlapping periods of time. The other is that the speaker can't be double booked for overlapping periods of time. That's a pretty common pattern, pretty common constraint. So another common pattern would be the equals for one attribute and the overlaps for another. One, you know, the room in this case indicates, you know, one resource, which is the room, and this is the time attribute here, and that indicates that's a this complex value that has a beginning and an end time. So I went through that a little bit quickly. Are there questions on this feature here, or why this is important? Okay, so this was new in 9.0, but as you can see, I used the example with 9.2 because it was just so much easier to illustrate. You see I used extensions, which make this easier to actually just go create this directly from my slides, because I don't have to show you how to install B-tree, just you install it using the package system for contrib on the operating system, and then you can just do this create extension. And that simplifies things.
So
yes?
Does that mean you could literally use this code in 9.0 if the extension had been put in place?
Well, this in 9.0, this could be used. There are two things from 9.2 that I used here. One of them is create extension, and that simplifies it because it makes the example more self-contained, right? The other thing from 9.2 I used is this range type here, which I'll get to those in a second, but you can think of this like the period data type that I just described. So in 9.0, you'd have to use the period type instead. The only reason I didn't put it in this slide is because I didn't want people kind of copying and pasting and using the period data type or thinking that they needed to. This is the newer way to do it, and it's more flexible. And so we can see that. But so as you can tell, I was a little bit torn on the order in which to put these features. One of them was, you know, ordered by the time they were developed. But yeah, so that's slightly confusing, and I apologize about that.
Okay, at the risk of sounding stupid, I'm in a dog over here. What is the width equals comma signifier?
So this is the attribute with a constraint like unique. You just need a list of column names, so you would have unique on user ID, right? Or let's say unique on, you know, user ID you know, comma, some other, you know, user ID and then a room ID, you know, to match them up or something like that. And so you just have a list. But with this, in this case, you have something a little bit more because room, you're matching with equality. And this one, you're matching with overlaps. So by adding the flexibility to use other operators aside from equality, then we need a way to specify that.
With is a keyword.
So with is a keyword. And it's just a way to associate the operator with the attribute. And that describes the constraint.
When did that become effective? What version of PostgreSQL?
9.0. Yeah, yeah. So 9.0, you can do this kind of thing. And so if you actually specified everything as equals, then it would be a unique constraint.
Would it work the same way with nulls, though?
If you specified everything as equals, then it would have the same behavior as a unique constraint with nulls, which, if I remember correctly, is just that basically anything that evaluates to null does not cause a conflict. So for instance, with a unique constraint, you can have multiple null values for the same attribute. Okay, sorry.
I was just going to say the way to read that is to exclude new rows where the room number is the same as some other row and there is overlap in the during column.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
And then you need to treat guests because you're using with equals in the exclude?
This is actually because you're using a gist index. It's actually because of both of these, because you need some indexable operator in order to enforce the constraint. It's kind of an internal implementation detail a little bit more, but you need the index type that can support these search conditions. So gist can support this overlaps. With this extension, gist can also support equality. Btree can always support equality, but in this case you can't mix and match, so I needed one index type that could support both equality and overlaps. And then by installing this, then gist was able to accomplish that.
Given that that should be a relatively, may not frequent, but a common usage,
mm-hmm.
Is it the extension now going to be almost required, not required, but why did they include it?
Small matter of programming. There was still some burrs on that one that made it not be default.
Okay.
Yeah. It's possible if this is a common use case. I mean, this is not necessarily my decision, and this
right.
At this point, it's not really a matter of technology as much as whether we decide to move it in or not. If it gets to the point where enough people are confused by having to install the extension, then we would probably make that change. But then again, we also want people to get comfortable using extensions because they're going to be pretty important. It's not really a technical matter, but it's become very simplified by making just one line now. And that's Dimitri Fontaine's work, that he did the extensions work. Back there? If you have everything as equality, so the semantics are the same, then the performance on, some micro benchmark that I did that was, basically just trying to measure that exact one piece of the system, I saw about a 20% difference, something in that range, and that's due to a minor difference in the implementation. It's actually very close in the implementation as well as the semantics, but there is a minor difference due to the need to do this kind of one extra index probe after you've inserted it. It essentially doesn't get one optimization that the Btree index gets. So there is a difference there, but it's pretty minimal. And when you have a larger case, it would ordinarily be a small part of the overall time. It would be my expectation.
Have you benchmarked the order of those two, putting the during before the room and the during before the speaker? Is there a difference?
There's no semantic difference.
Right.
They're a performance. I would have to think about that a little bit. There shouldn't really be a difference. They wouldn't be expected to be identical because the way a way a GIST index is built is a little bit complex and nuanced. But yeah, for performance questions, actually, I'd like to kind of punt those to the end a little bit, just because I'd like to move through some more of these features. But here's an example of the exclusion constraints in action. You know, so you have room 1, 2, 3. I didn't have much room to even, you know, put the whole error message here, but the error message is pretty nice, and it tells you what actually conflicts, and it gives you all this nice information so that you can track down where the problem is. And so this here is kind of a straightforward example of, you know, double booking the room for different speakers. Of course, if the speaker was the same, it could fire either of the exclusion constraints because it would violate both. So this is a simple way to avoid schedule conflicts. And it performs, as far as I know, it's the best performing way to accomplish it because it's doing the least work and has the finest grained locking. It won't block things unless there is a real potential for conflict, which is nice. Similar to a unique constraint, if you're inserting 5 and 6, doesn't matter if they're on the same B-tree page or not, one won't block the other because there's no way 5 and 6 can conflict in a unique constraint. And it's less error prone. I really recommend avoiding, if you aren't using this mechanism, I really recommend avoiding trying to kind of work around it and improvise a solution with triggers. These solutions are pretty error prone in a number of ways. It's easy to think you've got it right when it's wrong. It's easy to think that, okay, well, I'll take a big lock for now and not care if it performs, and then later decide to optimize it because you actually do care, and then it's wrong again. So there's a bunch of pitfalls, so I would just recommend against that. And then range type, so this is what gave us kind of the power to use that TSTZ range in the last example. So this is a generalization of the period data type. So now we no longer have to, for one thing, we don't have to go out and use this other extension, but also that other extension for the period data type was somewhat limited in a number of ways. It only worked for one data type. So range types are a generalization that can work for many data types, providing, again, the key aspect is that it's got a beginning and an end, and then a bunch of operators, and then the index support necessary. So as long as you've got an ordered data type, you can use a range. Some are built into the system, and if not, you can easily create your own range type out of some other data type, whether that subtype is built in or whether that itself is an extension you get from somewhere. So this replaces the period data type. So it also offers a lot of these built-in range types. So now, rather than only using timestamp with time zone as the period data type had, you can also use it for dates. Regular timestamps without a time zone, or non-temporal types. And then if you have some new type, or a new temporal type, or a slight modification of how you'd like the range of time to work, then you can create your own range type there. So it offers a lot more flexibility. And then when you define a new function that operates on ranges, then it'll work for any of the range types that you have. And when you define a new range type, all of the functions that you defined will work on all of those. So in other words, if you have a date range and a timestamp TZ range, and you define a function that works on a range of timestamp TZ, you automatically get it to work on date. And so you don't end up with that kind of explosion of operators and so forth. You can do it a lot more simply, manage many temporal types. So kind of a simple example of this is, I mean, sometimes you have you know, say a hotel reservation might be by day, check in, check out, and then a conference room reservation might be for a very specific beginning time, like May 17th at 2:30 p.m. So in that example, you'd want a timestamp with time zone range. Logically, they're very similar, so you don't have to try and manage these two different data types and worry if you have all the operators for both. You get them both here, and you can manage them in the same way, but just at a different granularity. And then for these cases, since these are reservations, of course, you'd want exclusion constraints here as well, but I just didn't have room on my slides to include that. So questions about range types? Oh, back there. I'm sorry? Yes, you can define float ranges. Floating point timestamps, if I recall, there are maybe a few caveats there because, well, for a number of reasons, I guess. But I'd have to think through, you know, for some uses, it's probably fine. I'd have to think about that. I think it's probably okay, but I'd be a little bit worried using float values with, say, an exclusion constraint or some other hard requirement like that. But if you're okay with the fuzziness of floats enough to use them and you're okay with the just running queries on them and not trying to define declarative constraints, I think you're okay. And that you'd accomplish by creating a range type with float 8 as the subtype. And then if you did that, you would get all the operators available for the other range types automatically, and you'd be able to create indexes on them automatically.
You were mentioning before about nulls or unbounded ranges. Are they looked
after? Oh, yeah, in the range types, it's got, it's not represented with null, or and it does not use null semantics. It's treated as, you know, an unbounded range where you just don't specify anything. It's kind of treated more like infinity than like a null. So although ostensibly nulls are supposed to kind of mean that you don't have anything there, then there are kind of some strange semantics defined in the standard involving comparisons. So you don't, we don't want to use those semantics. So we treat it more like infinity on one or either side. Yeah, that's a good way to describe it. Okay, so this, by the way, range types will be available in 9.2, so that's, you know, well on its way to being released, but it's not quite out yet. So these things I'll be talking about from here on out are future ideas. So these are fairly hand-wavy at this point and can and likely will take very different forms than you might see them on the slides. But it's, you know, problems that I'd like to solve that I think are important that would, you know, help make temporal data management easier in a number of ways or faster to use. So in this case, range keys and range foreign keys. So the idea here is, you know, there's a concept of a foreign key and a primary key on a table for these this equality. But for ranges, as we were saying before, there are other operations that are more important for range values. So a range key would be, for all the range values in there, you'd specify overlaps as part of an exclusion constraint. And for all non-range attributes, you would specify equality. And so that would give you, you know, if we kind of move back to this earlier example here, then it would kind of simplify this because since this is a common pattern, we'd want to be able to just define, you know, range key room, comma, during, with maybe some annotation to tell it that during is a range, or maybe it can pick that up on its own. But the idea is that that allows you to just, you know, do the common case thing just becomes a little bit of syntactic sugar, and then under the hood it would use the exclusion constraint. And then if you need more flexibility, of course, you could go back to the exclusion constraints.
So like in a use case, you just say like two tables, one table would say 1st of January, second table, which has it as a foreign key, is 1st of January, 10 a.m., 1st of January, 1 p.m., etc.
Yeah, that would be a good example of, I was going to move on to range foreign keys. That would be a good example of range foreign keys. So here I was just talking about a range key where you're specifying in a table that may be referenced or may not be, but just to avoid the necessity of, you know, these are a little bit verbose just because they're flexible, right? Whereas this common case here would be, you could just specify with a range key and it would automatically just be kind of some syntax sugar is what I'd like to have there. And then something that offers a slightly newer thing is, so range foreign key would do more like what you were suggesting, which is in the referenced table, you'd have a range key. And then in the referencing table, you would have a range foreign key that would mean that every value in the referencing side would need to be contained in the range on the referenced side. So this would be kind of the range equivalent of a foreign key, the range analog, I should say, of a foreign key. And that would allow you to very simply you know, if you have a, you know, in one table some, you know, trip that you're taking that might be for a conference, then all the activities that you have in some other table must be contained within the time that you're in that city. So you could imagine a system like that. Yes?
Are you intending to support individual values on the referencing side or just ranges?
Either one is definitely makes sense from a logical standpoint. How that's specified, you know, that might be something that you could, you know, choose. So if you had this is a little bit open to how you specify that exactly, but absolutely either could be done. And
The use case you cited one where a range on the referencing side would make sense, but we have like a statute.
Right. Yeah. So that's a good point. I mean, it would certainly be supported, right? That's kind of the easy. It's a subset of the other case. So, I mean, if you really needed to, you could actually just make a singleton range anyway, of that time point, which is one of the reasons why I wanted to support singleton range as well in the range case, is to make those cases more interchangeable. So.
If you like on the primary keys, I have 1 and 2, and then 3 and 4 as integer ranges,
mm-hmm.
and you had a foreign key as 2, 3, so it bounded both, that would be invalid?
That would be, my inclination would be toward invalid, and then on the referencing side, if you had, say, another non-range attribute. I mean, the typical case, you'd have a non-range attribute along with the range. Right, so you'd have ID 1, 2, 3 on the referenced and on the referencing side. So, you know, in that case, really on the referencing side, what you want is you want to combine those two tuples because you want ordinarily, and I mean this, you know, you can kind of do whatever you want, but my inclination would be that on the referencing side, you would want to collapse those ranges into 1, 2, 3, 4. You know, 1, 4 inclusive to be a larger range.
If you have the referenced side, you have the two ranges, only one range on the referencing
Oh.
What match two contiguous ranges on the primary?
Yeah, I think I misspoke, but either way, you'd want those two ranges that are adjacent. If the other attributes of interest are the same, you want to collapse those into one range. And that would be my inclination, although perhaps it could be done the other way. But that would be my inclination, is that you'd want to kind of make some assumption that that the referenced side was these kind of contiguous, non-overlapping ranges.
Seems like it'd be a conditional join, because you don't want the case where I must have the exact same range on both. The overlap must be complete, no gaps.
Yeah, so if they're the exact same ranges, you could actually use an ordinary foreign key.
Wait.
Yeah. But you'd want, I think that that contiguous non-overlapping is, an interesting property. Maybe whether we want to require that or not, I'd have to think about how difficult it would be to not require it, or whether it's too confusing to not require it or require it. But that might, that's been brought up also as another potential constraint that we could enforce that can't be enforced currently, but, the idea that, you can't, you can't add something that's adjacent. And so that might be another constraint that you'd want to enforce, add something that's adjacent with all the other attributes of interest being the same. So other questions about the range foreign keys or range keys? So another feature that I'd really like to see, and I'll show kind of an example query that applies here. And this is important, I think. Joins right now, the equi-joins are well supported in the system, right? There's three different ways to do an equi-join, maybe more than that if you count some of the variants. That's very well supported. But for joining ranges, I'll show a query here in a second, but the idea is that you match up based on the portions of the range that overlap. So rather than joining on equality, this is kind of a spatial join actually, but the idea is you're matching on the portions that overlap, and this will be important for billing queries, or actually many different kinds of queries, but I think the most straightforward is a billing query like this, where you have maybe some kind of rates in one table and usage in another for some service. And so somebody might start or stop using a service at an arbitrary point in time, at arbitrary points in time. The rates might change at arbitrary points in time as well, or perhaps based on the contract, maybe the rates change on an hourly or daily basis or something like that. So then the usage could span multiple rate periods, or a rate period could encompass many users. So you want to do a join and kind of take the portion that falls into that rate period and prorate it and multiply it by the rate so that you're able to actually get a useful bill. And there are many problems like this. I just thought that this was the clearest case. But you're doing this kind of matching based on the portion that overlaps on each side. Another example of this might be if you're doing kind of a fuzzy join and you want to kind of take say a log message versus some event that happens that's observed somewhere in the real world, and you want to kind of correlate a logged event with, that's recorded with the system's time versus another event recorded with some other system's time, and you want to say, okay, well, put a window of 5 seconds on each one, and now you have, these two events that are actually ranges now, and you could do joins on that as well. And then you could do kind of a fuzzy join in that way. So the idea, I call it range merge join, but the goal is I just want that query to be fast. So that's how far I've gotten in the design, approximately. I do have some ideas that I've proposed and some kind of pre-proposals how this might work, but it turns out there's quite a few different ways to approach the problem, and we'll have to see which ways look the most promising, and perhaps all of them have merit, in which case maybe multiple approaches would be implemented. But the goal here is to make those joins faster, because I think that those are going to become more common in these temporal applications.
Can I talk about the elephant in the room?
Sure.
Partitioning.
Yes. In what form, I guess, would be my question.
How's it going to work out?
How is what kind of partitioning going to work out? Oh, I would like that very much, yes. I'm not working on that, but I think that, especially since range types are in the core system now, I think that's a very good idea to kind of hold metadata about the partition ranges. We may be even able to use an exclusion constraint to make sure they don't overlap. For range partitioning, I think that makes a lot of sense. I really like that idea. I haven't gotten much further than that, than just thinking, okay, this would be a good way to represent the metadata. There are a few other problems with partitioning, of course, that we haven't settled, but that might make, that change alone might make partitions scalable to more scalable, because we'd be able to exclude faster. Much faster than doing the kind of the constraint exclusion that we're doing now, which I'm sorry for the terminology there, but constraint exclusion is the partitioning terminology for excluding based on a constraint, but it's different than exclusion constraints. I like that approach, and I'm. It is not here. Nobody has written any code to do that I know of. I believe that some people are working on that problem, but I don't have much more information than that. Then I like it. I'd like it to be done, but I'm not planning to work on that personally, but I might obviously be involved somehow. Okay. Was that related to merge join, or was that?
No, just the whole thing range.
Okay, yeah. So back to the range merge join. Then I think the idea here is to again, this is one of those cases I was talking about in the beginning, where to do this in the system a long time ago would be very expensive. It is able to, thanks to range types, it's a little bit better. It's able to use maybe an index nested loop. A nest loop with an index on the inner side, but if not for that, it would have to actually use a nested loop, just like for a non-equi join, where it's just a very slow kind of a process. So I think the range types did help a little bit with this query here, but we really are going to need a range merge join to make those useful for kind of larger. Larger kinds of problems or more complex problems that get a little bit more into analytics. Let me see how much. Okay, so another feature that I'd like to see, kind of going back to the original example, this can be done, but I'd kind of like to see this standardized. I mean, I think a lot of people have some very similar ideas what they'd like to get out of a historical table log. A lot of times that's really as far as the requirements go, is we need a historical table log. There may be a few specialized requirements, like whether the user is included in whoever created or deleted that record, and other things like that that a trigger might record along with the data itself and the time. I've got a question.
How would this be different from the time travel option that got sort of yanked out long ago?
I believe the time travel option you're referring to is based on transaction IDs and maybe associating those with physical times. I'm a little bit unclear on how that option actually worked, but it was related to transaction IDs and when they were committed, and then kind of you were able to do kind of a snapshot back in time.
You'd keep all the row versions.
Right, yeah. So this is a little bit higher level than that. I mean, for one thing, people rarely want to do that for their entire database unless it's a very strict environment. Usually it would just be a few tables that they really care about that have something to do with money or physical assets or something like that. So the other thing I would say is that you're able to collect actually more information this way because you have information about the user that actually performed the operation, whereas if transaction ID snapshots are all that you're using, then you don't have information about users and higher level, you know, access control related information like that. So I think that, this I'd like to see kind of a solution that's easier, you know, that can take kind of this simple requirement with maybe a few options and just do it, have the system take care of it. And I think that would make it much more common for people to do it, for one thing. It would make, the use case would be obvious, so I think it would kind of make people more aware that it can be done rather than needing to use a trigger or something on their own. And it would kind of standardize the way it's done, and that would, you know, kind of develop, some expectations so, you know, one person wouldn't forget to include some critical piece of information because it would be kind of one of the obvious options available to include. And people would kind of know what to expect from a performance standpoint and other angles. It would just be kind of a little bit more standardized. Other thoughts on this or questions about having a table log? Is this something that people here would value as kind of a quicker way to establish an audit trail for a table?
Okay. Quick question. DDL, how would, like, apart from the DDL to do it, would you just say no table changes once you put this in?
Oh, the you'd probably block changes to the historical log. That would be one of the things. I haven't worked out all the permissions yet, but you'd probably block changes to the history itself.
No. If at some point, you turn on the logger, and then you change the structure of the table somehow, are there things you'd want to not allow in that, or?
I don't think it's going to be a perfect solution there that's going to kind of magically, you've got a history there, so you want to keep the old columns. Maybe you could add new columns, that might, I don't see a reason why that would be, prevented. But maybe you'd need to kind of record the fact of exactly when that column was added so that way you knew that maybe some historical records, not only is it just null, but that they never even had the option at that point or something. So there might be some extra information you'd want to keep. But I think you could still allow adding of columns. But just the nature that you're keeping all those old records means you really don't want to remove columns.
Usually people who want the audit trail on the table also want priority over write there.
Priority?
Priority over write. They want to make sure that if they erase something, it's not there and nobody can see that.
I would call that kind of a special requirement. I mean, the idea, along with, when you offer something declarative to add a history log, then personally, I think it would be a bad idea to then also allow a way to subvert that. because then when you go back in time, you're actually not seeing the state as it was at that particular time, right? You're not, it's false. So maybe if you had special requirement, you could do that, but I don't know if I'd include that in the DDL.
Would this involve, is this implemented by, we'll throw a trigger on, or would we hide this somewhat lower level than this?
Probably a trigger. Yeah, I mean, unless there is some reason, you know, not to. I mean, I think a lot of things could be accomplished with a trigger here. I mean, did you have something in mind? Let me kind of rephrase. Is there some limitation of triggers that you think would?
People get irritated at, oh, we'll use a trigger for that. That is it.
Yeah. It's an implementation detail in this case. I think the, you know, part of the hesitation to use triggers is that they're not declarative, right? There. But if we're able to offer something declarative using a trigger as an implementation detail, I think that at least some of those concerns would go away because they'd understand that it wasn't just doing some crazy thing, that it had kind of a method to.
You do historical logging for a price table, and the object, or the product that gets priced, is in a different table. You also have to put a historical log on that other table. Otherwise, you have no idea what the object was.
Agreed. I mean, I think that's kind of the business requirements. If you want historical pricing, you either have to store the whole record and kind of, you know, do some sort of denormalized, you know, kind of pull that all that information out from the other table and stick it in the original one, or just log both, and then that way you can do a historical kind of a join.
This maybe plays into the range merge join piece.
I think it may in quite a few circumstances. In this particular case, I think what you'd be able to do is kind of do a snapshot query on both tables to get the old historical data. That could be done maybe with an index, kind of a scanner, get that snapshot somehow. Then after you have that, you've highly filtered it. Then at that point, you've got the snapshot. All you care about is the equi-join of those two sub-results coming back together. So I think you could do that with an ordinary equi-join, although there would be very similar queries that I think range merge join could be very useful for. So I think it's very close to a case where you'd want range merge join, but I think you could get away in that case with an equi-join in the existing system.
If you change the product, you alter the products table, so you've got a history in there,
If you wanted to do a join where you got results from many points in the historical time rather than taking snapshots of each, I guess as soon as you do the snapshots of each at a particular point in time, then you've at that point kind of made it non-temporal. But if you're not doing the snapshots, if you want like a kind of whole history of things going on and you want that joined result, then yeah, I believe that's true.
Like in the output, the time that you requested, a record, a row record of each table that you're looking at, and then whether that row record is a current, if there is no timeline, or what timeline, so you have three columns, two tables, three columns, a time, a row, and whether they're variable or fixed.
Yeah.
So,
okay. Yeah, I think you could do. So you're saying do a range join on the two history tables to come up with kind of a new history table of the of all the records.
One could be history. One could be static. Two.
Yeah.
Just make sure you tell the user this is current. This is not.
Yeah. Yeah.
If they didn't put an entry table there, that's their problem.
Yeah.
You still give them a meaningful result that's explicit. Mm-hmm. They can do whatever they need to do with it.
Yeah. I think, but that gives me kind of a better way of describing, I think, to Chris's question, is that, you know, a more intuitive way of looking at it is you could take the two history tables and join them and end up with a history table of as though you had just one table originally in the history of that. So you could kind of, the join of the history tables is the same as the history of the joined table. You know, I think that might be a better way of describing it. And let's see, I think I have one more kind of idea to throw out here while I've still got a couple minutes. So this is kind of a little bit out there, but it's been requested quite a few times, and I think that there's some merit here. It's just that I think that we need to kind of understand the semantics of this and the use cases for those semantics in enough detail to really, you know, to really find out what we want here. But the idea is that, you know, you have many different ranges, you're joining them together or unioning them or aggregating them in a union fashion. And obviously you can't have, in the existing range types, you can't have these multiple disjoint ranges that have a gap in between. That just isn't representable today in range types. This is essentially saying, well, yeah, you can even have gaps in there, and it's kind of like a bunch of ranges that are all ordered from left to right, none of which overlap, and none of which are adjacent. I'm still thinking about that one a little bit. I don't know if I can quite respond to that one on my feed. I'll have to.
Yeah, you store starting date and ending date, whatever days are in between are in between.
Every month in the season, 31st, right? This round is 28th. But depending on the year, it's going to be 29.
Well, the thing that motivated me, like bugging you about it, was aggregation.
Right. Yeah. If you want to aggregate a bunch of ranges, just to kind of repeat what he said, we already discussed this very briefly. But if you have many ranges and you're aggregating them, where the aggregation operator is union of the range, so you can imagine rather than like sum aggregating on plus, this would be this other range union aggregation. You know, combining the ranges with a union. Then you don't want this kind of one range that's kind of out, you know, out there someplace to throw an error because you can't union the ranges because they're not touching.
There was a similar thing where range minus range right now works just great as long as the range you're subtracting isn't in the middle of the range you've got.
Right. Yeah. So you can't subtract, cut out the middle, cut out a little hole in the range. So this would allow you to do those kinds of operations. I think that, like I said, I think that there's something here. It's been brought up several times, but I would need to understand the semantics and the use cases that need those semantics a little bit better to, you know, to really do a good job at something like this. I'm sorry, I can't hear you very well.
I think the simplest solution to this problem of huge range is to create all the operation as code for sets of data. So you intersect.
Right, yeah, but then we need a new data type for those to return as well, right? Because now the domain has expanded, right?
What would you solve with this that you couldn't do with an array of ranges?
That's a good question. I mean, so part of it is, you know, with the array doesn't have the constraint preventing, say, overlapping or misordered ranges, right? I mean, you'd ordinarily want them to be ordered and not overlapping, and so that constraint would be difficult. There's another problem with that, if I recall. But I mean, essentially, you know, it's similar to that. That's also been a reason why it hasn't been implemented already, is because we have this array of ranges. And so that can solve some of these use cases.
Even just user beware type of situation, be a stopgap. Is there where you pass in a master range and then a set of ranges and say, okay, what's left over? So a scheduling system, what hours are open type of?
That would be an interesting operation. I think probably the way this will go, this is out of the ideas I've presented. I think this is the most, you know, kind of at least from a semantic standpoint, the least understood. So I think one way we might kind of wait to see how people use arrays of ranges to solve these problems, and then see where that is weak, and then see if we can make a use case for multi ranges from that.
It's scary in two places. I think about specifying business use cases and secondly specifying user interfaces. Because think about having a web interface to something like this. Trying to represent a date range is pretty reasonable. As you have a date here, a date and time here, date and time here. Say set those two things. That feels okay. You start having to have a recursive object to control it.
If you're talking about from the user standpoint, maybe it's better to represent it as a picture.
There's all kinds of UIs that you could do with literally graphics.
So
you know, the number line is a fairly well understood thing.
Then how do I write a script that controls the silly thing?
Well, then the script can worry about the nested data structures. I think that's a very good point, right? I mean, there's not all that many interfaces that offer that much, and that kind of indicates the complexity of the problem, you know, and therefore kind of limits the use cases. So I think that I was responding a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but...
multi-ranges as part of the original input or as part of a table, but for this to be part of the interim result is perfectly reasonable.
From a theoretical standpoint, there's nothing that prevents you from having complex types, and those complex types can be anything. So I would say that I wouldn't reject it on theoretical grounds, but I think that, you know, from a best practices standpoint, if you find yourself using lots of multi-ranges and empty ranges in your base tables, you know, then there's probably some design flaw there. There's probably a schema design problem, and that they are more typically useful as intermediate results because of the closure. So I would agree partially with what you're saying. Yeah, there's a yeah, these things
paper on it before we're done.
Yeah. So, I think there's a lot of connection between what I've been working on and the spatial data types and work that those two guys have been working on. And I'm hoping to take advantage of some of that, and they've showed an interest in some of that.
The approach would be a good validation if you did the multi-stage. The similarity sets would be good to filter out quick and then use a simpler, more straightforward algorithm in the final phase.
Yeah, and you're talking about the range merge join now? So I think I was thinking about that a little bit during their talk. I would need to think a little bit more. Again, I'm not quite sure if I can respond to that on my feet, because there's, yeah. So I would like to spend some more time thinking about that, because if we're able to do those similarity joins more efficiently, because they're using an index nest loop essentially, and so if they had a better way of doing that, I think it would work with some of their similarity searches and some of their strategies. I think you can do it faster with some kind of a join than with the index nest loop kind of approach that they were using. But I'd have to think. I've got another question back there.
I'm not sure if you answered this question already someplace, and I wasn't here or just missed it. But for the range merge join, is there a thinking difference between using the Temporal approach or
that was my proposal that I submitted to hackers involved a pre-sorting phase. But that is not the only approach. So that's one of the things that we'll need to discuss. So the algorithm was kind of, pre-sorting based on the first, the lower bound of the range, and then doing kind of a merge strategy. Yeah, I'm hesitant to say. There's always some kind of processing of the data at runtime, right? So, if you have it's going to be involving some kind of a temporary index or a sort order or something along those lines. So, I'm hesitant to say, that it wouldn't do anything because, in a way, creating a temporary index is kind of sorting in a way. So anyway, I think you see where I'm going, and there's... Yeah, I wouldn't think of it as very free because, this is not an order that would be semantically useful in some other way. So it's not like we happen to have it sorted already because that's the order they put it in, or we happen to have it sorted this way because it happens the user wanted it in that order anyway. Because this would be kind of a strange order, right, by lower bound. And not that it would be useless, but just that I expect those opportunities to be less than what the query planner is geared toward finding already. But it's all kind of open for discussion. I think to that extent, I think that if the planner can find this sort order already and if it's already there, I think that this strategy that I proposed could have a lot of promise.
I've just been thinking about the disjoint ranges, and it seems like that would be a good solution for certain classes of scheduling problems. I'm not sure if you can think of any other solution. For example, in court, if you have two attorneys and a judge, and they want to schedule a subsequent meeting, they've got to say within this date range what times are available. Where all three people don't have something scheduled, and that seems like you could take a date range, a range of disjoint set of working hours within a date range, and exclude scheduled activities of three people.
Yeah. So this sounds like multi-range kind of use case,
yes,
potentially.
Yes.
Okay, so that I think I like that use case. I mean, I think that that makes sense. You'd be able to kind of cut pieces out of the schedule and then search within there. Yeah. I think that's a good use case. I'll have to think about it some more, but I think that's a good direction to go. Okay. Thank you, everyone.